Good morning, Grace and United Methodist Church. I'm Reverend Liza Marler, and I have the sheer joy of being your associate pastor. Welcome to Grace and United Methodist Church. Look at all this pink in here. Oh, my. It almost looks like Pepto-Bismol fell all over. Just kidding. Okay. Just kidding. As I make a mess. Dale's going to fuss at me for that. He knows I'm always joking. This is serious, so let me get serious. It is great to see all of you this morning. I want to share a few announcements with you. I have to show you this. Look at this hat. It says, God is good all the time. I'll be styling, right? And I got my hair all chopped off, so it'll be great when I have a bad hair day. I'll just put the hat on, nobody will know, right? So, fun stuff. This afternoon at 4 o'clock, there we are going to have from 4 to 6, trunk or treat in Grayson over at the playground. So we will be there, your staff will be there in our t-shirts, our Grayson t-shirts, and handing out candy and having fun. I hope you'll come and see us or come and join us. We'd be happy to let you hand out candy with us. So it'll be fun. And speaking of our GUMC t-shirts, well, everybody loved them so much, and some people didn't listen the first time. So guess what? We're doing another order. So how about that? So you can still get your t-shirt. Be on the lookout for how to do that. Grayson Table this week is going to be sponsored by the Anchor of Hope Sunday School class. And we're going to have pizza, salad, and dessert. And please make your reservations by 1 o'clock when?
Tuesday.
Good deal. Next Sunday is All Saints Sunday. And that is a time when we recognize all those who have passed this past year. We'll be ringing a bell for each name as it is said aloud. And if you have others that you would like to be read that passed away this past year, feel free to call Laurie by Tuesday at 1 o'clock and give her those names. Also, next weekend is time change. Go ahead. Oh, I hate time change. I wish they'd leave it alone. I like it the way it is. But yeah, it's going to start getting dark a whole lot earlier next Sunday. I also wanted to mention the Sam's Club, or the Sam's Group, is having their soup and luncheon on November 12th. So mark your calendars for that. I think I covered all that. We have someone in our, does anybody remember Pastor Carol Miller? You people aren't old enough, I guess. He was here in the 80s, and his beautiful daughter Lisa is with us this morning, so we want to welcome Lisa. It was Carol and Jenny Miller were here, I believe you said in 86, maybe? 1986 to 1990. So we welcome you. Let's all welcome her. We're so glad you're with us. The last thing I want to share with you this morning is all of this beautiful pink. Today's a special day. It's great to see again this sea of pink in recognition of Breast Cancer Awareness Month. We also have a display of the mastectomy and pork pillows that were made by the Circle of Friends. You see them here and here and in front of me, I think. And if you know someone who is dealing with cancer, breast cancer right now, and you'd like to take one of these pillows, you're welcome to take them. They will be taken to, they'll be distributed to Northside, Gwinnett, Piedmont, Rockdale, Eastside, and Johns Creek Emory Hospitals. Okay, yeah. You know, breast cancer has affected us all in one way or another, but that's not the only cancer that has affected us. So this morning, while we celebrate by wearing pink for breast cancer awareness, we also recognize all those others who have dealt with cancer. So if you have either had breast cancer or have a family member who dealt with that, would you please stand? And stay standing. If you have any other kinds of cancer that you have dealt with in your family or your friends, please stand. Do y'all notice anything? We have all been affected by cancer in one way or another. So we give God thanks for this ministry and for the opportunity to love each other through the cancer. Let's give God a praise. You may be seated. My own mother had peritoneal cancer. So all of us have been affected one way or another, whether it was in the last year or whether it was years ago. It's a very special time for us to remember and to love on one another. Let's go to God in prayer. Almighty God and Father, what a glorious morning you have given us to come together to worship you, to lean on you and to lean into your Holy Spirit, knowing, God, that you carry us when we cannot carry ourselves. God, as we celebrate all the many names that are across this sanctuary, all the many people in this sanctuary, all those who have had cancer of some kind or have been affected by cancer, God, we give you thanks for supporting us, carrying us when we could not carry ourselves, and helping us when someone graduated into heaven with you because of cancer. God, this disease has affected us all in one way or another. But we know, God, that when we cannot move, when we cannot feel, when we cannot do the work that you've set before us, we know that you carry us, you walk with us, and you hold us in the palm of your hand. As we worship you today, God, we give you thanks. We give you praise. We thank you, God, for all the caregivers, for all those who love unconditionally. We give you thanks for the opportunity to have your Spirit renew us today as we hear the words that you have prepared through Reverend Trenton's sermon today. As we sing the songs and as we say our prayers and as we do all these things, God, we know that you are with us and we love you so very, very much. We ask all these things in the most holy and precious name of Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen.
I'm going to invite you to stand as we worship. Guide me, O thou great Jehovah.
Oh,
light this morning as we say this historic creed. I believe in God, the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, dead, and buried. The third day he rose from the dead, he ascended into heaven, and sitteth at the right hand of God the Father Almighty. From thence he shall come to judge the quick and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. Glory be to the Father. Sunday of the month, which means it's birthday celebration Sunday for everyone that has celebrated a birthday in the month of October. You do not have to be a member, or you might be here for the very first time. If you had a birthday in October, we're going to invite you all to come forward and to line up in the front, the beginning of the month somewhere over here, the end of the month somewhere over here, and kind of join together as we cross the front. The rest of us, let's take some time to say hello to those around you and welcome them to our service today.
Let the church say amen.
Amen.
Say amen again.
Amen.
Say amen one more time.
Amen one more time.
It's good to be with you all this morning. My name's Trenton. I get the chance to be the senior pastor for those who are not aware. And we welcome you again to Grayson. Once again, this is Birthday Sunday. And we just want to do one more check. You don't have to be a member to have your birthday acknowledged if it was in October. And I will say, but she was in the other service, so she's okay. She's a member. She's a member. So you don't have to be a member. And I want you to do something and say, neighbor, is he talking about you? And if they sheepishly say yes, I want you to drag them. Drag them. In all seriousness, we want to be a family. And we seek and strive to be a family in all we do. One of those things we do is your birthday is special to God, so it's special to us. and we want to recognize it. So they're going to share their name, their birth date. Their age is
optional.
It's optional. You don't have to share their age. And one thing they're grateful for, one thing they did to celebrate their birthday, or a well wish that they have for this coming year for them.
My name is Karen Layden. My birthday was October 3rd. I celebrated by going out to dinner with my family and celebrated again last night going out to dinner with my family that included my brother, whose birthday is also in October. And I'm grateful for my family.
Good morning, church.
Good morning.
I'm Winifred Samuels. I was born in October, the 5th of October, 1941. I'm happy to be here. I love the fellowship in this church. I came to this church when I was in a wheelchair. So I have so much to thank God about. And now I am walking and I can run, I can do everything what everybody else is doing. And I must say thanks to Reverend for the wonderful prayer that he said before I went into surgery. So I'm so glad to be a member of this church, and I will try my utmost to see if I can get others to join the church.
I'm Pat Mayer. My birthday was on the 9th. I turned 68, which I'm proud of. I celebrated by going to the mountains with my daughter and her family and out to lunch with some friends. And my prayer for next year is that everything gets better than it has been for me in the last 2 years.
Oh, amen. 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 I'm loud and proud. I'm Liza Marler, and my birthday was yesterday, and I got to see a very dear, dear friend in the nursing home, and that was very special to me. And then, I'm 67, by the way. I'm a year younger than you. Ha, ha, ha. But I did get to see a very, very dear friend yesterday in the hospital, and that touched my heart. And I had dinner with family. And the celebration is not over. It continues. And my hope for this church is that we keep being family and in love with one another, but mostly in love with Jesus.
Amen. Hi, I'm Lynn Young. And I am 75 years old today. I'll celebrate with family and church family and friends. And it's a real blessing today to be able to be here with all these beautiful pillows for us to pray over these pillows. Please, if you know of someone who's dealing with cancer, feel free to pick one up. Take them a pillow and a prayer. And then later in this next week or two, we'll be delivering to the hospitals. Thank you.
Honor them one more time as they go to their seat. Amen. Well, it is the time in our service where we acknowledge God in the area of our finances. And often when we do that, from the concept of what is happening in the church or in the community as a reason that this is a great church to keep investing in. However, that is not the only reason why you give to your local church. You give to your local church because you are a follower of Christ. That is, and centrally, the main reason. You give because God gave. And we are stewards. We are managers of all God blesses us with. Are there days where you don't want to give, like you don't want to pray, or read scripture, or love people that are unlovable? Yes. But I've learned something, and I remember the first time I wrote my tithe check, and it seemed crazy, because my Acura 99 3.2 TL had holes in it, and Kristen was so gracious to me for sitting in that car when ants were creeping through the car, and I still remember shaking when I wrote my first tithe check, which is a tenth, because it seemed irresponsible, if I can be honest. God, you know my financial situation. Why are you asking me for 10% of what I receive? And you know what? I have never missed a dollar I have given. And I've grown, not just in how much I'm able to give, because my job situation obviously changed. I've grown because I realized giving drew me closer to God. Giving drew me closer to God. The scripture says that where your treasure is, there your heart might be also. So I'm so grateful for a loving God who journeys with us, but doesn't leave us where he finds us. So I encourage you, search the scripture for yourself. Understand his will and his way. And see your financial responsibility as a Christian as a way to continue to honor God in every area of your life. So I encourage you, if you are purposed in your heart to give, you would give online at gracemc.org/give. You would text to give, or as our ushers come forward, you would leave your tithe or offering in the offering plate. Let us pray. Lord Jesus, we give you thanks for being faithful, sowing grace upon all your children, even those who do not acknowledge you. You are good to them, and you draw them closer to you. God, I pray for each and every heart here, meeting them wherever they are, on their praying journey, on their scripture reading journey, on their witnessing journey, and even on their giving journey. Stir us more and more to see your hand in everything and your heart and plan for us, which is always to prosper us, never to harm us. Teach us so that we might be like you, mature Christians who walk like you. For those who give, God, I ask that you bless them. And for those who cannot and have not, I ask that you continue to bless them as well. And being your children in this world, we pray the prayer you taught us to pray, which is the Lord's Prayer. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespass, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen.
Come and I will.
says, no matter what we're going through, come, lay it on me. Let me carry it for you. What a friend we have in Jesus. Let's stand as we sing this wonderful lyric.
Church, would you pray with me? Spirit of the living God, we thank you for your presence here. I am with many who you love, and you understand and you see them. So would you use me as a vessel to minister directly into whatever situations they are in, and give them hope, give them faith, give them everything they need. In Jesus' name, amen. Hakuna Matata. Hakuna Matata. Thank you. Means no worries. Yes. Yes. Hakuna. Amen.
One more time.
Simba is an interesting character. You think he's okay adopting that mentality. You think he's doing all right. Only until his past catches up with him does he realize he's been running. And something he didn't intentionally do has kept him from not just home, but his identity. It was interesting to connect with Simba. My wife and I celebrated 10 years of marriage a couple of weeks ago, and I got a chance to go to the Fox. Amen. Thank you. Thank you. Yeah. Amen. But I'll tell you, this was emotional for me. 10 years was emotional for me. You see, it was after 10 years that my parents divorced. And none of my siblings, I'm the third of four. I was two when it happened. None of my siblings have made it thus far. I'm the first. And a part of me as a child blamed myself. Did I cause it? Was my presence? And you know, for a while I lived with that shame. Isn't that what kept Simba from going home? And you might look at me and you say, well, Trenton, I didn't know you were dealing with that. You look at Simba having fun with his friends and growing and living and being, and you, it's amazing how shame is right beneath the surface. If we're honest this morning, we have learned as adults, as humans, to keep going. But internally, we all can be dealing with feelings of unworthiness, not being good enough, taking ownership for things that have happened that are out of our control. Shame is a silent killer in conflict. Those unaware often enter into relationships already difficultly. Have you talked to a Falcons fan lately? There's great hope for them this year. But if you talk to some of them, they won't let their hopes get up, will they? They've been through too much. And a part of you will say, well, you weren't playing on that Super Bowl team. You weren't a coach on that team. Why do you feel the way you do? But shame is sneaky. Until someone evokes it, you may not even know you're dealing with it. You know, some days I come home and difficult day, difficult conversations, and sometimes those lies creep into my heart. Trenton, you're not good enough to be the senior pastor. Obviously, look at what's going on. You need to just step aside. Someone else is better for this than you.
Not to us.
Amen. But shame. Shame is an equal opportunity killer in conflict. You're not aware of the things and the identities you take on, whether you know it or not. You're already behind the eight ball and handling it well. It's a great conversation to have because our story today shows us that shame is not just reserved for those who do something wrong. Shame comes in various situations, which means we all are susceptible to it, no matter how good we think we are. We have to have a plan to deal with it. Or else, we will hurt relationships we walk in, and we won't be God's instruments in the world. In Mark chapter 5, we have a familiar passage for some of us because of the main character. But what I hope to do is show you, by the grace of God, that the woman with the issue of blood is all of us at times, and to see what Jesus does as a result. So let us look through this. Jesus had crossed again in the boat to the other side, and a great crowd gathered around him. And I hope you catch this imagery. And he was by the sea. Then one of the leaders of the synagogue named Jairus came in, when he saw him, fell at his feet and begged him repeatedly, "My daughter is at the point of death. Come and lay your hands on her so that she may be made well and live." He has no shame in approaching Jesus, does he? No, he's desperate. And when you're desperate, you don't care how God does it. You just want him to do it, right? And I think that's good news for all of us, right? God, I don't care how you get my finances in order, just as long as you do. I don't care how you get my kids in order, just as long as you do. I don't care how you get our church in order, as long as you do. So this is a great place to be, but there's somebody in our story who's not there. So he went with him, and a large crowd, once again, you see the crowd, followed him and pressed in on him. But there was a woman who had been suffering from hemorrhages for 12 years. Now, we don't know how she got this situation. Could have been that she had a child and miscarried, and as a result, now has a not functioning body. Back then, if sometimes people suggested if you had an issue like leprosy, where you had spots on your skin and you were blind, or maybe even this, where you were a curse. Somebody, you or someone in your family, did something wrong, and that's why you have this illness. And we don't know that about this woman who's been suffering for 12 years. And everyone would have known it. She had to wash clothes incessantly, would not be around people, because if something happened, if she hemorrhaged around, she would be deemed unclean. So she couldn't be a part of community. She wasn't fellowshipping with the saints. She was alone, isolated, for something she may or may not have done. Can you feel the shame in her life right now? Let's bring this to 21st century. You might know someone who was a woman in an abusive marriage with children, and she chooses to get a divorce and still may feel shame because she has now taken her children away from their father. You might know somebody who's dating someone, and they say, "You know what, I'm going to wait till marriage before we take things another step further." Can you guys catch my drift there? And the person on the other end of the relationship gets out of it because, well, this is a non-negotiable. I got to take the car on the test drive before we, you know, I put a ring on it, you know? And you don't think that person might feel a little shame of acknowledging, why was I not good enough to wait on? What about the man who's trying to do the right thing at work and sees other people at work not doing the right thing, and you know what? They choose to tell the boss and be a tattletale to help the place get better. And as a result, now he's shunned from the community. They don't tell him about assignments and projects. And you don't think he feels shame of God? Why did you call me to do the right thing and I feel like I'm suffering as a result of it? We are this woman. We suffer in silence because of what we are going through and how that forms how we see ourselves or how we think people perceive us. We're socially isolated, and as a result, we might be experiencing shame. She endured much under many physicians. She tries to fix it and spend all that she had. She's broke now, but she didn't get better. She got worse. Isn't that us when we try to fix our own stuff? And how is she fixing it? She's fixing it on her own. Sure, she went to the physician, but she is doing this on her own. Where was her community? Where was the crowd? The crowd wasn't with her. It was just her. And this is what we try to do to our own selves when we are in shame. We try to fix it, and sometimes, most times, it doesn't work out the way we want. But she heard about Jesus and came up behind him and touched his cloak. For she said in her heart, "If I but touch his clothes, I will be made well." And immediately her hemorrhage stopped, and she felt in her body she was healed of her disease. Now, here's where the community is so vital to how we navigate shame and culture. Immediately aware that power had gone forth from him, Jesus turned about in the crowd, that same crowd that has been pressing in on him, and said, what does he say? Who touched my clothes? Now, this is an odd thing for Jesus to ask because everybody's touching him. Does Jesus know who touched him? There's a difference in her touch than everyone else's. But he asked the question because he wants the community to see who is putting faith in him in the midst of their shame. The disciple said to him, "You see the crowd, how can you say who touched me?" He looked all around to see who had done it. But now the woman has the floor. She came in fear and trembling, knowing what had happened to her, and she told him the whole truth. Who else sees the whole truth? The crowd that was there listening. What does Jesus call her after her testimony? Now, let me ask you guys this. How many times does Jesus toss around the word daughter? A lot, you think? Not really at all. Jesus doesn't just heal her. He gives her connection. What is clear in the passage, what's clear for Simba as you watch Lion King, what was clear for me as I had my own issues with shame, is that I needed connection with a personal savior to deal with the internal conflict. If you or you know someone who is walking in shame, only a personal savior who can get on the inside is able to help them address the growing conflict within them. So it's interesting, because if we know we can't fix shame for our own self, but we are in relationship with people and conflict is ensuing, and we understand that they might be dealing with things. What do we do about it? Because this is good stuff, but if there is no prescription, we leave out of here without tools to help us. So what does God want us to do? I want you all to repeat after me. You ready? You didn't say you're ready.
Ready.
Behind a story,
is a story.
What if we approached everybody, let's take it a step further. What if we approached the difficult people in our life with mercy? What if we were merciful? Because Jesus preached to us in the Sermon on the Mount, we're blessed when we're merciful, because when we're merciful, we'll be shown mercy. The choir just sung a beautiful song of Matthew 11:28. Come to me, all you who labor and are heavy laden, and I'll give you rest. I'll address the shame going on in your life. But the church, you guys, we are the most equipped body to help people navigate shame in their life. You want to know why? When Jesus Christ died on the cross for you, he renounced the shame of the cross for you. Jesus was a curse on a tree for you. He heals us of our shame, so we are equipped by his power to help people navigate shame around us. So how do we do that? How do we show mercy? Well, on the back of your bulletin, on the sermon guide, I have some tips for how you help others deal with feelings of shame. How you want people to help you. One, create a non-judgmental space for them to share how they feel. How often do you sit with those in your life and ask them how they're really feeling? Validate their feelings by refusing to minimize them. Any of us guilty of that? What if Lois came home and said, "Daddy, my day was hard," and I said, "Guess what? Get in line. You don't have a hard day yet. You in first grade. You don't have a hard day yet. You ain't lived long enough to have a hard day. What have I just done?" I've minimized her feelings. And the next time she really does have a hard day, what do you think will be the result? She won't want to share it with Daddy. She'll hide it. Be an active listener by repeating what they said in your own words. You may not fix it, but you'll see them. And that's what connection is all about. Jesus saw her and got the crowd to see her. Isn't that interesting? And the crowd heard him call her daughter. The one who was suffering with hemorrhages for 12 years. You don't think connection's a big deal to God? It's a huge deal. Remind them of their value and their worth in Christ. Yeah. I don't care what you've done, you're still a child of God. If you've confessed Christ as your Lord and Savior, guess what? You are his. You realize that when you open this up and you read the New Testament, 2/3 of it was written by someone who authorized Christians to be killed. You don't think Paul dealt with shame? Yet he's a child. His worth to God was what mattered. Lastly, walk with them as God heals them by celebrating small victories. You know, there's somebody, I'm so grateful for my small group men that I walk with on a consistent basis who challenge me, who love me. And I was telling them about this guy that I've been ministering to. And he's growing, but he will not come into the church. He will not join the fellowship yet. And I was mad about it. I'm like, I'm investing all my energy into this guy. Obviously, I'm not investing all my energy into this guy. I'm embellishing because I'm angry. And one of my friends said, well, Trenton, what has he done? I said, well, he's reading scripture. What else? You know what? He acknowledged me the other day. He says, man, you're the only one who's taught me how to understand God's will in my life. Thank you. He says, Trenton, so you're having an impact. Have you celebrated that small victory? Ouch. It humbled me. The church, we should be champions of people in their stumbles, of their attempts to get it right over and over. So I don't know where you are, but dealing with shame well helps cure conflict. It does. And if we let God deal with us in our shame, God will continue to use us to be instruments of mercy. So I don't know how this sermon has spoke to you, but we do take a moment to reflect. So there's questions to ponder. But sit with what God has shown you. What is he teaching you through this passage? Would you do that? Sit with him for a moment. Lord Jesus, I'm so grateful that those who put their trust in you will not be put to shame. We'll always have connection with you. So no matter how we are feeling, our feelings will not be greater than your love for us through the cross. We bless you for these gifts of bread and wine. Make them be for us, the body and blood of Christ, that we might be for this world, the body of Christ redeemed by his blood. It's in Jesus' name that we pray. Amen. Here at Grayson United Methodist Church, we take Holy Communion every Sunday because we believe by faith when these elements are consecrated, God will work invisibly in your life for good through them. So this is an open table, which means that you don't have to be a member at our church to take communion. You don't have to be a Christian to take communion. You just have to be a person who earnestly wants to turn away from destructive behavior and thoughts that are not congruent with God's love for you. So if you would like to take communion but do not have elements, could you raise your hand? Okay, we have two up here. Thank you, Mr. Barfield. Anyone else? Thank you, Tom. Anyone else? Okay. Well, just a brief instruction. We take the clear part off. You think I'd get better at explaining this. Take the clear part off to get the wafer, then you take the bottom part off to get the juice. So, church, this is the body of Christ broken for you. you take and eat. Church, this is the blood of Christ poured out for you for the forgiveness of sins. Would you take and drink? Lord, thank you that you are the great overcomer. You give us yourself and you give us community so that we can heal and walk faithfully through conflict. In Jesus' name, amen.
And stand as we close this morning. Precious Lord, take my hand and lead me on. Let me stand. I am tired, I am weak, and I am worn. Through the storm, through the night, lead me on to the light. Take me home, precious Lord.
Today spoke to you and helped you navigate whatever God has given to you, and that you remember he walks with you and walks before you in every situation you might find yourself in. Touch your neighbor and say, neighbor, do you want to know more about Grayson? If they said yes, we're going to have our associate pastor, Reverend Liza, she will be, raise your hand, Liza, so people, they saw you earlier. She's going to be standing over here, ready and willing to greet you. If they said yes and they are willing to do that, would you walk them over to see her? If you'd like to talk to me briefly, I'll be in the Welcome Center shaking hands with people in the church and blessing them on their way out. But know that you are loved. We hope to see you if you guys have time in the park at 4 to 6 this evening in Grayson Park for Trunk or Treat with the city. And so many great things are happening in our church. Be in prayer for us as we continue to be a family together. Let us pray as we leave this place. Lord Jesus, we bless you, we honor you, and we acknowledge your lordship of our life. Lead us, teach us, challenge us to trust you. You are good and greatly to be praised. It's in Christ's name we pray. Amen. Amen.